This is a very difficult video to make. There is a lot to take in, there's a lot to review, and it is also my first time reviewing a documentary, but it won't be the last. First of all, I'm not here to criticize anyone who appears in porn, watches it, or works in the industry. What I am here to do is a critical review of a very popular 2023 Netflix documentary. I have to mention some of the politics and social issues around Pornhub, but this isn't in any way a history of pornography documentary, and I am trying to keep it as fun as possible. I know this is difficult to imagine if you are over the age of 18 but under the age of 25. Back in the old days, we used to find pornography in the strangest places. We used to find porn mags, also known as Scud mags, in bushes, in bush shelters, public toilets, even left in the back of taxis. Why not? Even in people's garden sheds. They were often full frontal nudity and dirty stories, like something you would read on Reddit. And the other thing you'd see is mostly illegally pirated VHS tapes, sometimes hardcore, sometimes softcore. But the internet in the early days was really like the Wild West. Pornography was everywhere, and most of it was paid for by a credit card subscription service. Sort of similar to OnlyFans now, but it wasn't so much personalized content. And what OnlyFans and also Webcam and also Model Hub, Pornhub's answer to OnlyFans, they broke down the fourth wall and interacted with the viewer and the subscriber a little bit better by offering not only personalized content, but also almost seeming like they're talking to the person. With mass-produced studio porn, you don't really get that level of interactivity because it's aimed at a general audience. And the reason why the internet was possibly a little bit slow to take off was because the internet was a little bit slow. It was really with the advent of broadband that the internet got faster at streaming videos. Bearing in mind, YouTube has been around for a while. It's not been around for as long as people think. I think it's been around since 2006, much like how Pornhub was started in 2007. Those were really the early days of streaming. You couldn't stream very much video because it was often really slow. Before then, it was mainly just pictures, some of them hard. Hardcore, but mainly images of very, very short videos. We're talking like 30-second clips. Free streaming sites are pretty much the mainstream now. Pornhub is one of the key factors in that. Quote John Ronson on an interview he did with Joe Rogan: if the outside world didn't care about music piracy, it sure as hell didn't care about porn. And that does seem to be the case. We're not bothered if porn studios profit. We're not bothered where our porn comes from, as long as it's not illegal and it's consensual and it's available freely. One of the things people say is, do you remember the last time somebody paid for pornography? Unless it's OnlyFans or a personalized video or a webcam of their favorite performer, probably not. Okay, so Pornhub started around 2007. It never really took off until a certain Mr. Fabian Thylmann took over, who is a self-confessed geek, by all intents accounts, a marketing genius. His tactics was to get the Pornhub name out there. One was to get it at the top of search engines. So if you typed in BBW with big tits, Pornhub would be the top three matches. It would come up with something like, I don't know, BBW with big tits MILF. BBW of big tits, fucking. BBW of big tits, homemade. What it'd do is it'd use the algorithms on Google, be the top of search engine rankings. Then his other tactic was to get the Pornhub name out there in the mainstream by having billboards in Times Square, which got taken down, of course. And he got the Pornhub name out there on late night comedy shows. I don't know how he did that, if it was just a coincidence of Pornhub being such a big name, it's in the pop culture canon, or if the tactic was to actually pay the people to mention it. It's difficult to say, it could be a bit of both. And Tillman's other tactic was to buy up a lot of the competitors, like My Dirty Hobby, like Webcams, like XTube, and then merge them into the company. Tillman sold his share of the company. The company that owns Pornhub became MindGeek a few years after Tillman was actually sued for tax evasion. And he settled out of court for, I think it was $5 million in Germany. And there's still pending court cases against him. And it's a bit like the Al Capone story. They couldn't do him for murder or extortion or racketeering, so they did him for tax evasion. And it's the same with Tillman. They couldn't do him for illegally pirating porn. And Tillman's ethos seems to be to profiteer from free pornography. And I know it sounds like a contradiction. How do you profit from something which is free? But however he did it, he did it. And without a doubt, Pornhub is one of the biggest names on the planet. I found out that it is the second most viewed porn tube site after Xvideos, which are owned by a Czech company. And they also own Bang Bros, Penthouse, and a few others. So as always, we have to be critical because it is a critical review. For some reason, Netflix documentaries seem to all have the same aesthetic. They have this sort of dark, moody feel to them. Could be because of true crime. I've seen the Jimmy Savile one this year. I've seen the Sons of Sam one a few years ago. And they all have a lot of close-up shots, mainly of computers and technology. And also they seem to have moody music in the background and this sort of clinical, sort of slightly dark feel to them. Not just because they're true crime, but also in the way they're shot. But that said, they are very professionally done. They don't feel like bad TV movies. But at the same time, they're this in-between space. They don't feel quite cinematic in the same way that something like Touching the Void does. Talking about bad TV movies about sex, if anybody saw My Massive Cock, that's honestly what it was called, on Channel 4 this year, that is an example of a bad documentary. It feels like an episode of The Undateables, an unaired one at that. It offered no real insight and it was very poorly done. Or you had something like Webcam Girls from a few years ago, which was also broadcast on Channel 4, but it's been re-syndicated via Netflix, and that's also incredibly dull. I mean, how do you make sex boring? Watch this and find out. Luckily, Money Shot is actually a very good documentary. I'd give it a 7 out of 10 if I'm going to review it. One of the criticisms has been that it's going for an unbiased stance, so it's not really very hard on the actual people behind Pornhub, but it's also not very hard, pun intended, on the people who are the critics of Pornhub, which is mainly Christian-based groups like Nkosi, National Centre on Sexual Exploitation, and there's been other pressure groups as well. And they do give those people an airing. One criticism I've got is the porn stars featured, I didn't know who they were. That could just be because I'm not really into that stuff anymore, but I am interested in sexual politics and, if you like, just documentaries and factual stuff, which is true crime related. And it is sort of a true crime documentary in a way, as well as a documentary about technology and social issues and pop culture to an extent. Because let's face it, I mean, pornography is pretty much pop culture now, you know? I mean, if you can buy a pair of Playboy underpants, then you can see how far pornography has come at permeating itself into mainstream culture. I think it does manage to achieve an unbiased angle. I don't think anybody being interviewed or featured on it looks particularly bad. I would have liked to have seen an interview with Fabian Thylmann or the current owners of Pornhub, but they were never featured. Another criticism I've got about the technical aspects is they did one bit where they did a voiceover. They used something to mask this person's voice because they wanted to be anonymous, and it sounds really bad. In my opinion, what they should have done is paid an actor to do the voiceover for him. Even if it was a comedy voiceover, I would have done it if they asked. We've also seen the aftermath of what were Christian pressure groups, such as Craigslist banning its sex services from its website, Twitter cracking down harder on pornographic images, if you like. IG, I think, have cracked down pretty hard on pornographic images as well. One of the things the documentary never covered is there's been a lot of breaking news. Well, I say breaking news, it's old news now. There's been a lot of pressure groups, mainly coming out after the Me Too movement, and we've heard Ron Jeremy be arrested. That wasn't mentioned in the documentary, but it sort of ties in with it. There was a collective which has since ceased, which is Girls Do Porn, where they owned a range of pornographic websites. One famous one was Mom POV. They also obviously no longer exist anymore. There's also no mentions of OnlyFans, which is effectively bespoke porn. Pornhub maybe modelled its model hub after. I can't be 100% sure of that, but they do seem like similar sort of user-based content. But it would have been nice to have seen them mentioned, how it relates and how they influence each other. So there's a few things they've missed, and that's mainly because of the running time. And the other thing is, I think this documentary will either grab you or it doesn't. The documentary starts off a bit corny. The question they ask for people being interviewed is, what was the first porn site you saw? What was the first pornography you saw? I think it's a bit of a trite question and not really very interesting. But they need to start it somewhere. What are they going to do? Show 2-minute montage of people being fucked up the arse? Or cum shots on people's faces? No, that would be too much. So they went for a sort of middle ground, and it don't really work for me. But I think if you stick with it, it's actually a really good documentary. It's been reviewed in various places. The best review I've read was on Den of Geek, which I will post a link to. There's also an article in The Guardian, which is quite interesting. And there's also a review in The Guardian where they gave it 2 stars, which I think's a bit mean, to be honest. I think it's worth at least 3. The review's not really very good, in my opinion. I'm not saying my review's better. That's for people to decide. And recently, what's been really strange is the Sun newspaper in the UK has been posting loads of really weird things linked into this documentary. There's been, who is Gwen Adora? Who is Asa Akira? Very strange time, and it smacks of self-promotion for this documentary to me. There's also a great Ron Johnson audio documentary called Butterfly Effect, which I will post a link to as well. If you want a more detailed picture, I do recommend you check that out. It's also a shame John Ronson wasn't interviewed for his documentary, but I digress. So all in all, this is actually a very good documentary, and I'm pleasantly surprised. I do recommend you check it out, even if you've got a vague interest in it. There's some bits where they're a little bit boring and it drags on, but I do think overall it was a lot better than I expected.